The machine's on.
No title. Take one. Here we go.
Wait a
minute. CO62291. Number two. Take
wait
one.
Wait 1 minute.
It is one of the single greatest achievements in recorded music.
It's a cornerstone record, not only for jazz, it's a cornerstone record for music.
It's sort of like, you know, the Bible in a way. You know, you just have one in your house.
I think I bought 3 copies. I got the records, you know, the albums, real albums.
I put on So What while I was going to Temple University. Every morning, the alarm clock went off, I hit the alarm clock, and then I pressed the button, and the record dropped.
If you listen to this record, you know, from a ballad to the blues to, you know, swing and groove, I think it encompasses all those things.
It's the prototype 50s vibe, cool.
There was an intensity and a purity and a devotion to that music.
Any great art, it becomes classic. And Kind of Blue certainly fits into that category.
It shows John and Cannon and Miles in top shape at the best of their game.
And I heard that group, I said, whoa, that's what I want to do for the rest of my life.
When we did this Kind of Blue thing, I thought that was special, but not as special as it got to be.
I was just talking to Jimmy Cobb, the last living person from that date, and he was just saying he would never have thought it would have gotten all these accolades.
Yeah, I didn't expect 40 years later that it would be the top-selling jazz record of all time. Just felt like another great Miles Davis record.
It's as strong today as it was for me in 1959.
I think it was just another great album by Miles.
It's poignant. It's beautiful.
A door opening.
Absolute bliss.
A spiritual, religious thing.
A holy calling.
Kind of Blue felt like it was made in heaven.
Well, one thing about Miles, he was always searching, and he was always at the forefront. You know, he led the way. He would do something, and everybody else would copy after what he was doing.
Miles was always moving forward and always in search of young talent and always developing his style to the next level.
Miles Davis had the awareness and the forethought of looking at people's musical chemistry and selecting the chemistries of different musicians that he knew, even before they played together, he knew it would work.
The band was a workshop. Miles really kind of talked to everybody and told everybody what to not do, not so much what to do. He never told anybody what to play.
One time I think he tried to tell me something about playing the drums, and I told him, let me play the drums. You know, that's how good we knew each other. I could say that to him without getting fired, you know.
His music kind of represented who he had in the band.
Wynton Kelly was one piano player that was working in our band after Bill Evans had left. Then there were Cannonball Adderley, John Coltrane, Paul Chambers, and myself.
All those cats, man, they like superheroes, like, you know, they have superpowers. The Justice League of Jazz.
That was the Miles Davis sextet. Miles had worked out a whole feeling that he wanted that evolved around the way him and Bill played together.
You can't say what the stronger influence is, because Miles is the leader, and of course the way he played set the tone. But the harmony, or the, in this case, lack of harmony, but of substitute type harmony that is so prevalent on Kind of Blue, is definitely Bill Evans. He loved Bill so much, he said he used to call Bill up and tell him to put the phone on top of the piano and play, and Miles would be on the other end. I mean, that's how much he admired Bill's playing.
They got together and talked about the different forms for the different pieces, because these were not hard copy written pieces, but developed by talking about it at the keyboard and with the trumpet. Bill wrote about this in the actual liner notes, comparing it to Japanese painting on parchment.
Bill's approach on that, on the notes, to, you know, put it almost in a Zen cone setting, you know, the instant, the moment, being there type stuff, which is what jazz is anyway, the essence of jazz, yet with a looseness that was like the Japanese brushstroke. In other words, we go, and wherever the stroke ends, that's the art. Performance of each thing is what you're hearing. If you can get that first fresh take and it's good enough, generally that's, you know, a real good one. And that may account for, you know, some of the success of this album, that all of those takes are the first takes.
Miles's idea was that he wanted to capture the spirit of discovery in the music. So if you work it out so that everybody knows everything about the music, then you've gone past the spirit of discovery. He wants to capture discovering the music on the record.
It does have a spontaneity and a freshness that very few records have. And being a musician, I know sometimes when you all get together to play with really good players and you try something for the first time, it's never better than that moment that you all conceptualize it the very first time you try it and it works.
It's very seldom you get one take and you're happy with it. You know, that means it's supposed to be.
That's such a great tune. I mean, I had to pause after playing that.
You know, everybody knows So What.
Miles told me that everybody likes So What. Those were his words.
And I just always remember just that being just a cool title for a song.
The tune So What that he did, that he always used to say that.
So what?
The introduction to So What, the part where Bill and Paul play together sounds like a, meant to be like a big band, sort of a opening kind of a thing, you know.
It doesn't start with a big fanfare with a big bang, you know. It almost starts with a whisper. The bass line starts, Jimmy Cobb doesn't play ding, ding, ga, ding, ding, ga, ding. He plays ding, 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 ding. You know, you're not knowing exactly where it's gonna go.
It kind of confused me, you know. I'm trying to say, where is it? Where is it going? What does it mean?
At the beginning of Miles' solo in So What, I hit a downbeat on the crash cymbal.
The first solo starts and Jimmy Cobb just plays a cymbal crash, bang, you know. Not real loud, but just with just the perfect kind of emphasis.
I thought I'd hit it too hard in the studio. I thought it was something I was gonna have to do over until I heard it.
And then Miles plays beep, boo, doo. Simplest notes. You can't get any simpler than that. There was a concept that was used throughout the record called modal playing.
This particular album, Kind of Blue, was, you know, one of the first. Modally, as opposed to how jazz music was beforehand.
Instead of having all of these tremendously sophisticated chord changes or various harmonies, Miles said, instead of doing all that, let's use a mode or a scale.
It gives you a chance to expand a little bit, move away from being locked into certain chord progressions moving in a certain direction.
He was trying to simplify, but simplify is not really the right word. You know, he was trying to make it clearer. Maybe that's the right word. And that's a way to do it would be to break things down to one tonality and play on it.
The simplicity of Miles's approach is unbelievable, harmonically and melodically. I mean, if you put that on paper, you'd say, come on, it's almost too trite.
Bill Evans wrote Flamenco Sketches. It's a scale, but in the music, Bill Evans, over each chord, says, play the major seven sound.
People weren't writing for jazz this kind of idea before. There were usually melodies, you know, tunes with a harmonic foundation. But here's something that's a conceptual idea. No specific melody, but the idea of playing off of five different scales.
If you listen to like flamenco sketches, the understatement of it makes it that much more grand.
Another interesting thing on Train's playing is the absolute simplicity that he plays on the major scale on Flamenco Sketches. I mean, completely lyrical, completely simple, only the notes of the major scale. Almost sing-songy, nursery rhymey type things, but again, the way he plays it with such passion and with such a great sound is what kind of makes it so convincing.
I sketched out Blue and Green, which was my tune, and I sketched out the melody and the changes to it for the guys.
Bill Evans sets it up, Miles comes in just like this. Ooh, that sound is so eerie. I mean, he didn't have to play any more than that.
That trumpet, that harmon mute with the stem out, man, that sound is like, you know, that's a real cool sound in that respect. You know, you see smoke rising from the, you know, from the floor.
The harmon mute that he's, you know, so famous for. He would, you know, on the, because he'd take it out the horn and throw it on the floor and press his thumbs into it. So I thought to myself when I was 17 years old, well, maybe that's how he gets his sound.
Watch the snare too. We're picking up some of the vibrations on it.
What it goes with?
What?
Blue and Green, Miles would come and says, on this tune, I want to hear a floating sound, you know, like, I say, okay, floating sound. So I wind up with something like this.
Blue and Green is just the most romantic, ethereal, dreamy experience.
If you want a record to make love to, Kind of Blue is the record.
Get into the mellow and set the scene.
There's a certain swoon that happens to women when they hear that record.
He was very sexy, you know?
Miles had some piercing things that meant just romance. It meant sex.
And by the time you got to Flamenco Sketches, if you want to get over, you over. If you hadn't gotten over by then, you weren't going to get over. She wasn't going for your little game.
Miles was playing from his heart. I think that's what where the swoon comes from anybody, from all of us, either sex, you know.
You get a full variety of emotions on the record, let alone musical textures.
He had a lonely kind of, when he wanted to, he sounded all alone. like he was sitting on an iceberg somewhere out in the South Pole, alone. What a beautiful sound.
John, very, very dark. Very dark, always entering, very darker than Miles could be.
John Coltrane and Cannonball.
You hear Cannonball Adderley, you, it's always joyous. It's the preacher, it's bouncing, it's happy, it's full of life.
Julian was, he was a jokester. He loved to talk a lot, though. He could talk forever.
Bill, you really get a kind of downtown feeling. I mean, can't be escaped when you listen to Bill Evans. It's really kind of, you know, it's dark. He's a dark cat.
Wynton Kelly, perfect foil for Miles's sword. There's the elegance, but there's also the street.
Coltrane had a melancholy thing to me. Like, and there's a difference. I mean, when you get into words, it's hard to describe, but sad is sad, and it's a certain thing. Melancholy is sad, but not completely sad.
The beauty of the sadness kind of spirit to it.
That's good art. When it can touch a lot of people in a lot of different ways, bring about joy, bring about sadness. That's the pinnacle.
Freddie Freeloader, that has kind of a happy sound.
Well, the reason he named it Freddie Freeloader, because this guy named Freddie, and he always tried to get in free, you know, to the musicians. So that Miles nicknamed him Freddie Freeloader.
This guy, Freddie Freeloader, he was a hard guy, man.
Oh, yeah, I remember Freddie very well. And he truly was a freeloader.
The piece is really set up kind of as a showcase for Wynton Kelly. The horns play a little fragment, and then Wynton answers that with this larger statement.
For me to describe Wynton's playing is like if you're playing on a bandstand and it's not really happening, and Wynton starts to play, it happens.
And the vehicle is a blues, but it's a kind of blues. There's a sense of the blues. That's a thread that kind of links all the pieces together.
The feeling of the blues is universal. I mean, that one, you know, this thing, you know. There's something about those intervals. I'm sure that they have a way of telling us why by now. You know, some chemical must get going. Some electronic stuff goes in your brain that says, yeah, that's home, I can dig it.
They're all different kind of blues. Now that's a pretty blue, and that's a funky blues. That's a happy blues, you know, so that's just kind of blue.
I would have swore he meant more about just the color, just the many colors, many shades of blue.
Blues, that's the foundation of jazz, you know. So he uses that word as part of the title.
To him, I guess it sounded like it was some blue music, and that's probably why he named it like that.
You know, boom, da-dee-da-ding, the first time I went to the Blackhawk and heard the band play that, I walked in and a thick atmosphere was over the whole club. It was just a mood that was set throughout the whole composition.
Here we got this kind of funky, bluesy bass line. Bill plays a double trill, you know, with his left hand and his right hand. I mean, that sounds like Ravel or something.
My color all blues, you know, a little fluttering figure I play at the beginning. It's just something I throw in.
A wonderful choice that Bill Evans made, you know.
The beginning, the do-do-do-do, you know, that's, it's like you're going down the road, you're going someplace special, and it really takes you there. You know, yeah, I love it.
big Cannonball fan. I think he's great.
Cannonball coming in and sometimes playing like he was getting paid a penny a note.
His playing of the blues is especially great because it seems as though he had great blues roots.
After Kind of Blue had come out, a lot of people were showing up. They'd never actually come out and listened to jazz before.
I really don't remember when I first heard it, because I'm sure that a lot of people will say the same thing. It's like it's always been there.
The music from that record was on everybody's lips. You know, everybody was trying to play those tunes.
Learning So What and Freddie the Freeloader, this was just my introduction to jazz.
That is definitely something I think any modern musician, especially an improvisational musician, is definitely drawing from.
I think that its influence is all throughout every bit of music.
The thing about Kind of Blue was that it was a complete expression. Many jazz albums were made with contrast in mind.
I thought it could have stood an up-tempo tune on there, you know?
Kind of Blue had contrast, but it was almost like a suite.
I think in many ways that was like Marvin Gaye's album, What's Going On. It was an album that was coordinated as an album. One tune went into another.
Miles made so many great albums, recorded so much great music that I cannot for the life of me figure out why that one particular album is the one that is chosen, you know, to be the one that sells the most albums.
It's something that we will never understand. No one knows why Beethoven's Fifth Symphony is his most popular. But thank heavens he wrote it.
Almost every place I go, there's somebody that will come up to me and says, when I first started listening to jazz music, Kind of Blue was the first album I ever heard that got me hooked into this music, you know. This is often, you know, I'm talking about everywhere I go in the world.
Here's a record that I could recommend to anyone from any country, of any age. If you want to hear the spirit of jazz, listen to Kind of Blue.
Miles feeling about Kind of Blue, I never heard him make a comment on how he felt about it. You know, he had a thing about not looking back on things. You know, he wanted to keep going. Like you would say something to him and say, man, why don't we play this? He said, man, I don't want to go back there.
I was very fortunate to be in Miles Davis's band. It was a wonderful thing for me. It's about the best thing that happened to me, put my clothes on.